was part of the whole evolvement of it, of rock and roll. I call it the birth of the beat rather than the birth of the blues. Birth of the beat being that the backbeat, you know, earlier we were talking about electric blues. Well, it was the backbeat, that strong backbeat in the urban electric blues that then influenced Chuck Berry and Bo Diddley, and then went on to evolve with the Yardbirds, Eric Clapton, Rolling Stones, et cetera, et cetera.
When Elvis Presley first came out doing a thing, he was doing the Slowly Mama thing, and that tune belongs to Arthur Big Boy Crudder. And they didn't call it the blues. They called it rock and roll, but it was the blues. So this is a thing that I don't understand, you know. If he did it, it's rock and roll. If I did it, it's the blues now. What's the difference?
Well, quiet as it kept, you know, if you listen at Hendrix's Voodoo Child, you know, that's the same thing I was doing in my. Well, I go to the mountain, down, down with my drive. See, that's the same licks Muddy Waters doing. But he had all his pedals and his different thing working for him. But he would tell you if he was living, that was Muddy Waters licks he was playing into the, what they call the psychedelic type of guitar playing.
Blues have been ever since the world was born. So they've taken rock and roll from the blues and hopped it up, just into everything that we are saying, man, the woman that left me, and the woman saying the man that left me. And they just jazzed it up and pepped it up and made it loud and called it rock and roll. It was the same as blues, but blues just mellowed out. See, rock and roll come from the blues. It's the same lyrics, the same thing I'm saying. You cannot do a song without saying something about a woman, about a man. A man got something about a woman got something about a man. So rock and roll is just a name. It's the rock and roll blues.
I joined Wolf in 1954. I was kind of young at that time. And in other words, he was like a daddy, like a father to me. If it didn't, I wouldn't have stayed with him 25 years, you know. But this guy was a worker. Not only did he had soul, he had everything. And nobody had a voice like him.
And I had a woman once, she was kind of nice to me, and she pulled off and left me. And that gave me the blues, sure enough. I went to howling like a dog then, you know what I mean?
Sometime we would go and rehearse in the garage. He had a garage behind his house. And me and him would sit there, me and him and Willie Dixon, big Willie Dixon, and get to iron the stuff out. But I'll put the music to mostly the numbers. Right here, I'll give you a little idea. Morning at midnight. A relationship one another that really I had the sound, he had the voice. It just went together.
It could be a spoonful of coffee. Could be a spoonful of tea. But a little spoon of your precious love. Good enough for me. Men lies about that. Some of them lies about that. Some of them lies about that. But everything fight about a spoon. That spoon, that spoon.
Stones came in, they had a television show on called Shindig, if I'm not mistaken, and they refused to play it unless they bring Howlin' Wolf, and white America was asking, who is that? And who is Muddy Waters? And they said, you don't know Muddy Waters? That's who we named our group after, one of his famous records, Rolling Stone. And that kind of talk there made goose pimples come on me, because I think they did a tremendous job with letting the world know that there was a Muddy Waters, a Howlin' Wolf, a Little Walter, a T-Bone, and people like that.
Well, when we first started playing together, we started playing because we wanted to play rhythm and blues, and Howlin' Wolf was one of our greatest idols, and it's a great pleasure to find he's been booked on this show tonight. It really is a pleasure.
Thanks to Howlin' Jack Wood.
So I think it's about time you shut up and we had Howlin' Wolf on stage. Yeah.
It was wonderful on the show. We all sat around in like sort of acolytes. The thing that surprised us when we first toured America, that when we did interviews, we used to talk about, as we talked about in England, we used to say, oh, well, you know, our music is based on these people. We made no pretense that we made up this music out of nowhere. And, you know, we love these artists and we named these artists and no one had ever heard of them. And when we got to America, we were surprised that they hadn't. None of these interviewers, well, obviously they hadn't. They were like from teen magazines and they were used to talking about the Beatles and Fabian and whatever. And we used to mention them and they'd never heard of them. So we were surprised. So we used to do this same thing, saying, well, these are our favourites and our band's named after Muddy Waters. And they'd say, who's that? And we'd go on to make this list of our favourite performers. And we were very surprised that they'd never heard of them.
Well, my mother told my father just before I was born, I got a boy child coming, gonna be a rolling stone. Sure enough, he's a rolling stone. Sure enough, he's a rolling stone.
So there were white performers playing blues in America. It wasn't that we were the only or first ones. But I think they were generally surprised, and they were surprised about that we knew quite a lot about it. It wasn't that we just done one song and then we went on our way. We'd done a lot of songs. We knew quite a lot of the background.
I don't want you be no slave. I don't want you work all day. I don't want your money too. I just wanna make love to you, baby. Love to you, baby. Love to you, baby. Love to you. I don't want you wash my clothes. I don't want you keep my home. I don't want, cause I'm tired of you. I just wanna make love to you, baby. Love to you, baby. Love to you, baby. Love to you, I'm still by the way that you wish I am home. I'm still by the way. Way that you reach all, man. I can
love you, baby, till I'm 14.
The Stones especially understood that underlying sexual magic in the electric blues, and they incorporated it into their music. And I think a lot of the sexuality of Rolling Stone music coming right out of the Chess Records vaults. They understood the alchemy. Maybe they didn't intellectually understand it, but they were able to transmit it musically. They came to Chicago to record. I think they came looking to get the Chess sound, but I'm sure there was a strong symbolic thing about them coming to Chicago to record.
Yeah, it was a good sounding room, and we got a much better, I think it was a much better sound. And also there was this element of this homage to this place, you know, that we'd all heard about. So those two things. But it was a better sound, and we felt that we were treading on sort of hallowed ground a little bit.
Also, I think Chuck Berry came by during those first
sessions. Well, we walked into a Chuck Berry session, and he came to listen to our playback of Around and Around.
Did you feel a little awkward having him there?
Yeah. We were very cocky, though. There's no doubt that though we were sort of in awe, after the in awe day, we were so cocky. I mean, it was a very cocky thing to do, to go and into this blues studio where no English people had recorded. Yeah, and Chuck Berry comes in, and so Chuck Berry comes in. So there he is, you know.
Did he say anything about you?
The only thing I can remember him saying is, you nearly got it, I think. His accentuated on the nearly.
Did some of the blues artists seem surprised when the Rolling Stones became so popular, singing a lot of their older songs? I know they record Muddy Waters songs, Howling Wolf, Chuck Berry, Bo Diddley. Did any of them express any thoughts when that first happened?
Well, the first thing they would say, man, I did a better job than that. You know, that, which is, you know, you expect them to say that. And I believe that if you know, that there was a difference in span of time, I believe if the jockeys would have played the originals at that time, they would have been big, very, very big. But it wasn't accepted at that time. I went to Boston on a promotion trip one time, and I took a bunch of records, and I went to see one disc jockey, and I never forgot it. And I gave him the records, and he looks through it, he says, "Yeah, this I can listen to and play. This I can listen to and play." And he got the Howling Wolf record. He says, "I don't play this." And he threw it on the side. I says, "Well, what's wrong with it? You didn't listen to it." He says, "I don't play that kind of music, you know." And I never forgot it. It kind of bothered me, you know. You know. And he says, "Well, it's a black record. I don't play it." Not meaning he don't play black people. It was a blowdown blues record, and he didn't want to play it.
I feel like it was a big help when a lot of the white rock groups did a lot of the blues recording, you know, some of the Howlin' Wolf tunes and the Muddy Water tunes,
and
like the Rolling Stone, Eric Clapton, and all these people. What it did was it opened doors and helped a lot of the other blues artists, you know, like myself, to, you know, really accomplish what we've been working hard for all these years.
At the beginning, blues were a big thing with black people in the South and those who had came up from the South to Chicago. Then it died down. It died off, and our blues artists were starving. You know, they could only work in a few blues clubs around Chicago, Detroit. They weren't doing well. Then white people discovered the blues. The Newport Folk Festival, where they had Muddy, that was the beginning. And all of a sudden, a whole new market opened up, and they're worshipped, you know? It was a whole new world for them to be admired by white people.
Got my mojo working. Got my mojo working, buddy. Just don't worry. We'll be right back.
go working, but it just don't work on you.
I used to do gigs with just, you know, sit-in gigs with Muddy Waters with the rest of the Stones on numerous occasions when we went to Chicago. And I was a little bit in awe of Muddy Waters at that point.
Now, when I was a young boy, at the age of five, my mother's child's gonna be the greatest man alive. But now I'm a man, way past 21. You got to believe.